Hello there, fellow model makers, and welcome to the second edition of my beginner's guide series on hand painting scale model kits. This time, I will build the Italeri 148 scale Hawker Hurricane Mark I. The choice of the kit, the camouflage scheme, and the techniques I will share are largely based on the comments and suggestions I received after posting the previous hand painting series. I thank all of you who took the time to watch the series and share your feedback with me. Last time, I had built a 72nd scale Thunderbolt, so this time I decided to build a larger scale kit. Many of you had asked me to take on a more challenging camo scheme, so this time I will try the famous 3-color RAF scheme. I would like to point out here that I could not get the exact paints for this kit, since I could not step out and buy paints on account of the virus lockdown. But I did find paints in the stash that are fairly close to what is needed. Lastly, this particular video is the complete build, and time limitations prevented me from going into too much detail. However, I will follow this video up with a more detailed multi-part series. A little about the markings on the kit. The LE code is for the famous 242 Squadron. Its commander was the legendary Sir Douglas Bader. The pilots in the squadron were mostly Canadian, and this particular aircraft belonged to the Canadian ace, Willie McKnight, who had 17 victories to his credit. Unfortunately, McKnight was lost on 12th January 1941. He was only 22 years old. Right then, without any further delay, let's get on with checking out the kit. We have the instructions, one large plastic bag of parts, a very nice reference manual, the decal sheet, and a small photo etch plate. Let's start putting the cockpit parts together. As you can see, many parts have flash on them. I run my hobby knife along the edges of these parts to get rid of the flash and crisply define the edges. Before I start painting, I will give the parts a coat of this Tamiya Fine Surface Primer. This has to be done outside since the can throws up a lot of primer and it is not a good idea to inhale the stuff. To paint the cockpit, I will be using green zinc chrome. Okay, here is a question that I was asked a lot. What is the correct ratio of paint to water? The thing is, there is no correct ratio. The consistency of paint varies from one brand to another, and also paint tends to thicken with time. So there is no universal ratio to dilute the paint. It is much better to develop a feel for the consistency of paint rather than work with ratios that in my experience do not work. What I look for is to get a very light layer of paint that is diluted enough to self-level. I make the first layer of paint the lightest to serve as a base layer and provide traction for subsequent coats of paint. The second thing I'm looking out for is to keep the coat of paint as free of brush strokes as possible. Diluting the paint helps. The other thing that you must do, or rather must not do, is to keep fiddling with the paint after you have applied it. Let the paint self-level and dry. If you keep fiddling with the paint as it dries, you will leave brush marks in it. Do not mistake paint patches for brush strokes. The patchiness in the paint will even out with subsequent layers of paint. The brush strokes are harder to get rid of. I keep applying coats of paint till I get an even finish I am satisfied with. In this case, it took about 4 or 5 coats of paint. Please note that I apply some layers diagonally to the previous layers to get a more even finish. For the black parts in the kit, like this instrument panel, I used a black surface primer to paint. If you do not have a black primer, just use a brush and black paint like we did earlier. The primer does not do anything special other than cut down on the time. I will use this varnish from Mr. Hobby for the build. This one is gloss. I will also use the matte version. I would advise that you buy these two or something similar to this for yourself as well. It saves up on a lot of time and provides an excellent finish. Also, they are not really expensive and one can lasts across multiple builds. Now, there are many branded washes available in the market. But this being a beginner's guide, I decided to show you how to make a simple but just as effective oil wash. All I do is dilute some brown oil paint with some turpentine and apply it. The wash will help define surface details better. I let the wash dry up a little and then wipe away any extra wash. Since this is an oil wash, it takes several hours if not days to dry. I can simply wipe it away without using any spirit or solvent. To add chipping to the surface, I use AK Interactive's True Metal Steel. You can use any metallic paint you have at hand, since the principle of applying the chipping remains the same. I use a piece of common sponge to apply the chipping. Just make sure you remove any extra paint from the sponge before applying the chipping, or you will end up with huge blobs of paint rather than fine chipping. I now glue in these super fabric seat belts from Edward. I just thought I would use this one piece of aftermarket just to show you. These belts are very fragile and the only glue you can use with them is PVA glue. Anything stronger and these will simply melt. The Italeri kit comes with photo etch belts and you can use those as well. I now give the parts a coat of matte varnish to dull down the shine and to blend everything together. Now to glue the cockpit parts together. The kit also comes with an engine, but since I will not be keeping the engine exposed, I will not dwell too much into its construction here. The fuselage halves are now glued together. While gluing larger pieces like these ones, I apply the glue in small, more manageable sections, rather than gluing everything in one go. This gives me more control and a cleaner finish. The wings are now put together and glued in place. To mask the canopy, I use Mr. Marking Sole. You can use any commonly available marking fluid to do this. Alternately, you can also use masking tape. There are some large gaps in the engine cowling, and I use Liquitex modeling paste to fill these gaps. This is a water-based putty, and the advantage of using water-based putties is that once dry, any extra putty can simply be wiped away using a Q-tip moistened with water. This helps protect the surface details much better than having to sand down the area. Before we start painting, I take a paper towel moistened with alcohol and give the kit a thorough cleanup. If you do not have any alcohol at hand, you can use soapy water. But make sure you wipe away any soap before painting. The surface has to be absolutely dry and soap-free. The front canopy is now glued in place, and I paint it with the same green zinc chrome that I used for the cockpit. This will ensure that the inside of the canopy frame matches the rest of the cockpit. Time now to start painting. I start with the underside of the kit, which will be painted duck egg green. I am using Vallejo's Model Air Paint here. This water-based or acrylic paint is meant for airbrushes and so is already diluted. But for brush painting, I need to dilute it a little more with water. Here is the important thing to keep in mind. I dilute the paint to the point that it is runny, but not so runny that it just rolls off the plastic or collects in huge pools. Just apply the paint as evenly as possible. If it pools anywhere, spread it and even it out. And lastly, watch out for any air bubbles. Bubbles in the paint will destroy a nice smooth finish. Once the paint is applied, leave it alone and do not keep fiddling with it. That is also very important. Do not worry about the patchy paint at this stage. Subsequent coats of paint will even out the patchiness. Just try to keep any brush marks to a minimum. A Another question that several people asked was how long to wait between coats of paint. Well, acrylic paint dries really quickly, within minutes. But just to keep on the safer side, I wait about half an hour between coats. The next coat is applied diagonally to the direction of the first coat. This helps get a more even finish. It takes multiple layers to get an even finish. In this case, it took about 6 coats of paint. Now, the number of coats required may vary from one brand of paint to another. However, I have found that multiple layers of very light paint seem to give me the best finish. But do remember to keep the paint diluted and do not rush the process, else you will get a thick layer of paint. Thick layers not only hold brush strokes, but they also cover up surface details, which is something we want to avoid. I now have to mask one side of the wing for the black paint. Now, there is a problem with masking while hand painting. The diluted paint often seeps under the masking tape, spoiling the paint job. Last time when I did this, a couple of subscribers suggested that after masking off an area, I apply the original coat along the masking tape, which will seal it. So here I am doing just that. On to the black paint. For this, I am using Life Color Satin Black. Since it is a really dark color, it only took 3 or 4 coats of black. And now for the moment of truth, removing the masking. And what do you know, it works. There was some leakage here, but this was completely my fault. I had diluted the paint way more than was required, but the rest of the finish is really clean. Any spillover was cleaned up with a Q-tip moistened with water. This usually works. If it doesn't, one can always clean up the area with some duck egg green, like I am doing here, to clean up the boundary on the scoop. For the main camo scheme, I start with AK's RAF green. I use a finer brush to paint the edges of the scheme. For the rest, I continue to use a flat brush. However, a couple of coats later, I realized that this supposed RAF green was not really the color I was looking for. It looked more like the US Air Force olive drab than RAF green. So I switched to this paint, Camouflage Green from Vallejo Model Layer. I kept applying very thin layers of paint till I hit an even coat that I liked. For the final camouflage scheme, I chose Vallejo Model Air USA Flat Brown. Because I will be painting a camouflage pattern, I gave up my flat brush and went with a nice soft rounded brush. Thin, watery coats of paint. Once all the paint was applied, I took a 200 grit sanding sponge and gently polished the surface to smoothen out the paint even more. I was very careful to ensure that I did not go through the paint. The sanding was followed by a little bit of repair work. Here and there. I was really happy with the finish that I got. The kit was now given a coat of gloss varnish. However, I made a mistake here and went overboard with the varnish. This would later prevent the wash from filling some of the panel lines. Not a major disaster, but it would have been better if I had kept an eye on the thickness of the gloss coat. With the gloss varnish dry, it was time to apply the decals. Time to start some chipping. The first thing I do is take a shade of brown that is a little lighter than our existing base coat. In this case, I went with wood. In case you do not have a similar lighter paint shade, just lighten your existing base paint with some white. Now using a fine tip brush, I start chipping. I stick to panel lines and areas where one can presume there would have been more wear and tear. I also enhance the chipping in some areas with a sponge. The same technique is used for green camouflage. This time, I use gunship green for the chipping. You can stop at any point you think you are happy with the chipping. For instance, right now this aircraft looks lightly weathered. I would have stopped here, but since I want to demonstrate more techniques, let's add some more discoloration in some areas with the sponge. To weather the kit even more, I use some metallic paint. I think this was aluminium. And add some more chipping. Only this time, I stay inside the chipping I had added earlier with the lighter shades of the camouflage paints. Just one thing to keep in mind. The Hurricane had large parts of the fuselage and control surfaces covered with canvas. So do not add metallic chipping in these areas. To give the kit a wash, I used some black and brown oil paints and diluted them with turpentine. This wash was then liberally applied all over the kit. I let the wash dry for about an hour. This is an oil wash, so it takes a long time to dry, and then simply wiped it away with a paper towel. For the black area, I used a lighter color. This time, I am using buff. With the wash applied, I give the entire kit a coat of matte varnish. I now use some black and white oil paints to add the smoke stains around the exhausts. To paint the smoke stains for the guns, I use soft black pastels. For the black side of the wing, I use soft white pastels. Time now to start working on the sub-assemblies, starting with the propeller. I once again turn to the black primer to paint the blades quickly. The propeller is put together and then I use a fine brush to paint the spinner with the duck egg green. Once again, light watery coats of paint till we achieve even coverage. Finally, a little cleanup with black. The tips of the blades are now painted with yellow. Once this was done, I gave the propeller a coat of gloss varnish. With the varnish dry, it was time for the decals. I now use some sponge and aluminium paint to add chipping to the propeller. And as with all other parts, a final coat of matte varnish. Right then, fellow model makers. Finally, the completed model. I hope you enjoyed the build and possibly learned a few things. If you did, please don't forget to like the video. Also, please do keep those comments and suggestions coming. Remember, I will soon be doing a much more detailed video series of this very build, since I had to rush over some parts to keep the length of this video manageable. So make sure you check those videos out as well. Till then, good luck, stay safe, and happy model making.